Welcome to this lecture, which is the final lecture of this year's series, of the Dean's Lecture Series. And we are very pleased and very honored to welcome Jeanne Gang, the founding principal of Studio Gang in Chicago, here to Melbourne this evening. My name is Tom Cavan. I'm Dean of the Faculty of Architecture, Building and Planning at the University of Melbourne. And it's our great pleasure to host this lecture series. I'll begin the proceedings this evening by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land in which this event is taking place, the land of the Wurundjeri, and I pay respect to their elders and families, past and present. So the Dean's Lecture Series here at the University of Melbourne has developed into a forum in which we hear from global leaders across the realm of the built environment. And this evening, Jeanne Gang will explore how today's cities must cope with vast industrial era spaces after their intended uses have lapsed. Using examples from Studio Gang's recent and noteworthy projects, Jeanne will propose how architectural practice might refocus to help reimagine these territories and initiate transformation, and thus leading debate and translating this to action. So we're not alone in our enthusiasm to hear from Jeanne about the innovation of the work of her innovative practice, Studio Gang. During her short time in Melbourne, she's been interviewed by the Australian Financial Review and Architecture Australia, the Architects Radio Show, I think, as well as meeting with students and practitioners, and including our budding architectural journalist, the MSD student-led Inflection. So it's been a very busy few days. Jeanne is also engaged with industry leaders in architecture and design here in Australia and met many of our students. Jeanne, of course, has won numerous high-profile awards, and most notably the MacArthur Fellowship, which is an extremely prestigious award in the United States. The Academy Award in Architecture from the American Academy in Arts and Letters, an Emerging Voices Award from the Architectural League in New York, and the 2013 National Design Award for the Smithsonian Cooper Hewitt National Design Museum. And in 2009, she was named a Fellow of the American Institute of Architects. So it's no surprise that this distinguished visitor has listed such excitement locally. Jeanne has a vision for a studio collective of architects, designers, and thinkers who work across the disciplines to address pressing contemporary issues. And it's for that that the studio has become internationally renowned. And it resonates tremendously with our Melbourne School of Design. The practice has, of course, produced some of the most innovative and award-winning architecture, including such large scale as Aqua Tower, the Northerly Island, and then, of course, the Nature Boardwalk at Lincoln Park Zoo, spanning scales from large to small. So I hope you've had a chance to see the exhibition, which is in the Wonderlic Gallery in 757 Swanson Street. If not, it's up for the rest of the week. Please do go there and look at the work that's on show. Jeanne is a distinguished alumna of the Harvard Graduate School of Design and taught at Harvard, Yale, Princeton, Rice, and IIT. And her work's been published and exhibited very extensively internationally, including the Art Institute of Chicago, where this exhibition was first shown. And at that showing, it set a record for attendance at the in Chicago. So you've got a unique opportunity. So this evening, we're very honored to welcome you, Jeanne. Thank you for coming.
Well, hello, everyone. Thank you for inviting me to this amazing school and city. I'm really taking a liking to Melbourne. I think I said it right. It's an incredible place. It's almost, I have a big crush on the city right now. And so hopefully I will be able to come back. Today I want to talk about our practice, and especially focusing on aspects of the city, the post-industrial city, and using Chicago kind of as the muse of our focus. But I think that a lot of the conditions that are found in Chicago can also be applied to other places around the world. I'm also going to try to reflect on some of the research approach that we do in our practice and share some of that research with you. So starting with Chicago and my office, right now we're located in this part of the city which is very vibrant and urban. It's called the Polish Triangle is the name of this part of the city, which is, there's everything going on there. You can probably have every kind of food possible, and you can also buy a wig if you want one right across the street. But it's a base, it's a place to use to seek out places in the city. One of the first projects that I worked on when I was really just starting the practice, and a competition came up and we decided to go after it, was for an environmental center in the south side of Chicago near this very post-industrial landscape. And I think the starting with that, just a few comments about it, it really had an impact on the approach of our office moving forward. There's a massive area to the south of the city that was former wetlands that had then become a kind of waste dump, really, for industry. You can see in this photograph that the landscape behind, the topography that you see, is actually just landfill. Otherwise, it's a completely flat area. And so I'm trying to understand that the impact that the industrial age, which really is Chicago was owes to its growth, the impact of that on us today and how we as architects and designers have to think about it differently. That in studying this area, we found that it was possible to tap into some of the materials that existed in all the places shown in red are places that had materials that could be potentially used to make a building. And at the same time, we discovered that this site really became an important migratory fly route for birds as well, as they make their way along the Great Lakes, coming all the way from South America, going all the way to the north twice a year. And so the combination of these two factors led us to thinking about a building that could be made more like a nest, something that would be using materials that could be available and nearby, like a nest, but also protecting the birds as they move through this territory from striking the window glass, which is very common. Something like 93 million birds every year die in America alone, crashing into windows. And so as an architect, it was very disturbing. You don't want to make a building that's, you know, killing the birds people are coming to see in this important project. So we combined these ideas about how nature is intersecting with the city and the important principle of reuse, and won this competition for the Ford Calumet Environmental Center. And I hate to say it, but it's not built yet. I'm not giving up on it, but 10 years in, it's still partially funded and still a dream that could become reality, as it seems that every 2 years it gets a new burst of activity. But it was really a project that started to integrate and synthesize the systems of the building, the concept of the place, very interwoven into more like a living organism than a building. And so that kind of project really resonated with us. So as our office grew and we start to grow size-wise and in complexity of projects, we actually really maintained a diverse people coming from all over the planet, all over the globe, to work with us, a diverse group. We maintain this research approach. Oftentimes we'll have salons in our office where we take a subject and invite people in and have discussions about that topic. So there's a component of the practice that is really research-oriented. One of the more recent pieces of that has to do with studying this industrial river waterway that we have in Chicago. The research on the river ended up resulting in this book called Reverse Effect. I don't know if anyone's heard about it, but in Chicago there's a river that used to flow into the lake, and then through a grand engineering project, this flow was reversed in order to save this drinking water. So the Reverse Effect book was really embodied the research, but it was designed to be communicative with the public, as many of the policies about the river were coming to the fore. The history of the river, this river, is really one of a grand industrial scale project of canaling the river. As I said, this image is about 100 years ago when they did this project. It was 26 miles of built canals. In this map, you can see the red lines, which are the canal zones. And what they did essentially was to take the river that was draining into the lake that was heavily polluted and threatening the drinking water, and make these canals that passed over the High Point, the subcontinental divide, and then connected it up to the Des Plaines River and ultimately the Mississippi River, which empties out into the Gulf of Mexico. So it was a huge project and involved transportation and waterways. But the result of this, you know, which at the time it was, you know, it was okay to do this for saving water for the residents of Chicago, but they really weren't thinking about the downstream end of this project. So this was a project that I asked students at Harvard to think about. It was a kind of almost the hardest project I could come up with to give to the students, you know, because it involves transportation, it involved hydrology, understanding neighborhoods, and also this aspect of invasive species that a result of connecting these two waterways. And so the students were asked to design a barrier to return this water body back to its original watershed. And that is an actual proposal that's out there. The idea is to build this barrier that will stop these carp from coming up the Mississippi River. They were introduced, and they're kind of filter feeding fish that are decimating the food for the fish in the Great Lakes. And so they're really scary too. They like to jump out of the water when boats go by. You can see Layla's frightening this poor woman as she's going by in a boat. But these effects of the river ended up being, you know, that we have poor water quality, we have flooding of basements and flooding of streets, the invasive species, and then also this abandonment of the industrial zone around the river, and which is also a great potential too, and how to re-envision this. So for the book, and to look into this further, we started to interview people that were actually in a kind of renegade way using this polluted river for various activities. We called them the kind of river constituents, people who were rowing on this river, fishermen, scientists are using it, and some green entrepreneurs and people who are leading tours with tourists on the river too. And the whole book centered on solving this issue through a series of steps, because it's such a large-scale issue that it can only be done in a more incremental way. One of the first steps was really to imagine giving people access to this former industrial waterfront. And by giving access to the public, you're basically building more support for caring about the river. And ultimately, the idea would be to disconnect and reestablish that watershed and create these freshwater lagoons that would be recycling water and returning it to the lake. So to help the public envision this, in the book we showed the way that it looks today, you know, with the industrial foreground, and how it might look using using natural systems and ecological systems to actually assist in the change of this area. So that was a project, you could say, without a client, except for it was a project that was designed to help move this issue along. And since then, you know, and I'm not saying it's just because of our work, but a couple of things have happened. They have passed an ordinance where Chicago now has to disinfect a wastewater before it's put into the river, and it also two of the polluting power plants along the river have also closed. So there's movement on this, and at the same time, we chose to go after a very small project, which was two boathouses along the Chicago River. And the reason why we went after this kind of smaller project was really because it fulfilled that first step of giving people the access to the water. So this project recently opened just last October. It's the Chicago Boathouse. There's going to be two of them, one on the south side and one on the north side. It's about 30,000 square feet and divided into kind of these two parts. One is boat storage for the long boats and rental kayaks for the public. And then on this side, there's a kind of a field house that has indoor training because we have very cold weather in the winter, and they can use it all winter, and a community space and training facilities upstairs. We wanted to make this building attractive and to have people realize something's going on along the river. We started to look at movement of rowers. This is a diagram that shows the position of an oar every second during one motion of rowing. And this is just to reveal a little bit about the process. We built a model of the oars, and not knowing really what we were going to do with this. And we ultimately found that we could translate that idea into a roof form. So you can see how the motion of the hands down, the hands up, and the transition in between starts to transition into this study model here that shows two different truss types, one with a low valley and a high peak, and a transition in between, all designed with straight elements. Once we found a Clara story was in the project, we started to mine that for more what it could produce. And one of the big benefits was really just using it for solar warming in the winter. We don't have a full mechanical system in the boat storage building, but people do use it in the winter for repairing boats and for working out. And so the Clara story gives us warming sun in the winter and also natural ventilation in summer. And we were able to outperform a standard building of this type by 57%. This is a view looking into the structure. The trusses are aligned with the structure of the boat racks and on these truss lines. And this is what it looks like with boats inside. And like I said, they're all straight elements in here, so it's very economical building. These are all straight trusses, and then they're clad with plywood, which is bendable material that is able to accommodate that curvature. So in the boat storage building, you can see the different peaks and the access to the river. And clad with a slate material that allows us to, you know, get the three-dimensional shape defined. Inside the field house piece, we really had to custom design these row tanks. We could only afford two. One is for rowing on the left, one's for rowing on the right, but we found we could also put a full team down the center and use it like that, and I think that was the first time it had been done in the boathouses that we studied. And this also has flow to it, so you can actually simulate rowing in those winter months. But the way that this is being used now is the park district, who's the owner, offers courses there, which are taught by the row teams and the row clubs. They have courses for people with disabilities. They have courses for elderly people and youth courses. And then as well in the building, there's an upstairs that's really a community space. And this is a space used by students when they're after school. But you can see, again, these two different trust types. In this building, it's a Virendale trust that's spanning across the second floor. And again, there's just two trust types, and then this transition in between, clad with the flexible material of wood. This is a view looking out toward the balcony through the ergometer rooms, exercise space, with a big terrace balcony where you can watch the boats coming in down the river. So the slate really helped us to clad a very complex geometry on the outside with small elements. But it's also important to demonstrate in this project that no water should be going directly off the building and into the river. You know, we're trying to show to improve the water quality. So 100% of the water from the building is collected into rain gardens and filtered down into the soil as opposed to runoff into the river. So the river looks very, you know, Arcadian, even bucolic in this view, but in fact it's still really a highly polluted waterway, and the idea of the boathouse has helped build momentum toward a better future. This is the bay at the end of the building that has its open air, and it has the coaches' boats in there, and fuel is stored in that end, but it kind of announces the building at the waterway. And here you can see its location in relation to the city beyond. So water is one of our interests. I don't know why. I'm a Pisces. I don't know if that's right, but we really seem to be doing a lot of water projects. The Aqua Tower was actually, we never really thought about water for that building. It was more about strata, you know, strata and rock. But anyway, it's interesting how this collection of projects, water and cities, are really intertwined. This was the Lincoln Park Zoo project, where there was an old kind of 19th century representation of water in the city, reflecting pool for promenades and for looking at. But over the years, this particular pond had become very, you know, polluted and run down. It was only 3 feet deep, and it was fed by city drinking water. So it was very wasteful to clean the water all the way up to drinking level and then put it into this pond. So in 2006, we were asked to reconceive this pond. And what we did was really work with incredible engineers, hydrology engineers, landscape architects, ecologists, and try to reconfigure this pond into something that was actually functioning as a wastewater management tool. We essentially deepened it significantly from 3 feet to about 20 feet, ripped out the edge and put plants in that are cleaning the water, and then ring around the pond with a boardwalk and pavilions so people could actually engage. So I think one of the things that's really interesting to me is how cities can become more dense, but at the same time make really significant use of their open spaces and allow them to be more interesting and biodiverse. The pavilion is made of these bent wood elements, prefabricated elements that were brought onto site. They're kind of bent in two directions, and they create this pavilion, which is sited so that you get views of downtown from here. It's very simple. It's covered pavilions used for for classes, school kids to learn more about water and the pond. And it's also used but for many other things, like people are using it for yoga and classes, and a lot of like architects are getting married there now. That's like the best thing. It's a nice space. So this was taken in the first year of the space, and it's really starting to come into its final, its more mature plantings at this point. And it's an incredibly popular place to be. But at the same time, it really acts as a kind of a, like a zoo without cages, and that there are some migrating, some birds that come in called the black-crowned night herons, and they there were 40 pair that were using the space, and now that's increased to 400 pair. So it's packed with people and animals. There's also, these are coyotes that are using the space at night, which are, they're pretty big mammals to have in a city. There's about 2,000 of these in Chicago, they estimate. But they're very good urban animals because they can use small space and they help keep the rat population down as well. People are using it for dance. This is a dance company that we collaborated with them on another project. It's nice to see a multi-use project that's really integrating urban nature and architecture. So this part, I just want to talk a little bit more about density and cities. And so this is a view of Chicago from way out in the suburbs, and you can see how sprawling it is for miles and miles and miles. And I think, you know, one of the reasons, one of the things we rely on for cities is infrastructure. But if we only think about infrastructure as roads, and bridges, then it doesn't make community. So I think we should start to redefine infrastructure. And I tend to think of tall buildings as infrastructure. So in Melbourne, you have, you know, lots of new tall buildings coming up. And I think it's important not to fixate so much on the individual designs of them, but how do they work together and how can they be, because you know, they're going to be around for a long time, and they are really residential dwelling in a city is kind of the DNA of the city. So it needs to be considered really well. When we got the opportunity to design a tall building in 2004, and it was what became known as the Aqua Tower, but when we were designing it, it was called Building P, and it was kind of, you know, anonymous building. But when we got that opportunity, and I never really thought that we would get an opportunity to design a high-rise, but we stepped back and said, what does it mean to do this, and started looking at these numbers and calculating what the density would mean. So in this view, you can see that the same amount of households that live in the small footprint, and this is just like a screen grab from a typical suburb outside Chicago, and the difference in area, but the difference in area also translates into a carbon footprint, you know, for per household. We use some research by the Center for Neighborhood Technology, which is a Chicago entity that calculates these density patterns, and so. You actually have like seven times the carbon footprint if you live in that suburban pattern versus if you live in a more dense pattern. So there's something really important about tall. I mean, and I think there's a good discussion that could be had about like how tall, you know, it does it need to be. But there is value in kind of condensing the urban footprint. So as we started to decided to do more towers because I think there's a lot of room for improvement, let's say, on some of the residential towers, and it's a very hard challenge because there's not a lot of there's not a very large way to innovate. It has to be very focused. But as we started to design towers, and now I think we've designed probably about 15 towers, but, you know, during the financial crunch, none of those actually got built. Now we finally have three that are underway. But we started to, this is a diagram that shows kind of the morphology of our designs of towers, and it's really about the ideas. So it's a branching out of ideas that really originated with the Aqua Tower, ideas about just having an exospatial building, you know, space on the outside of the building, ideas about the sun. And these various ideas have taken different forms, and these are some of the models that were displayed at the Art Institute show, along with some of the images that you see in your gallery. So there's a lot of research here, and with towers it seems to be that the research is transferable, you know, except for some of the climate information, but because it's such a particular building type, you can actually reuse this, and it's a body of knowledge that's growing. For Aqua, it really started out, it's an 82-story tower. It's mixed use. It has a hotel, apartments, and condominiums in it. And it's, the guys in my office like to talk about like what, how it ranks in height in, you know, with the other towers in Chicago. So it's 12th. And it's great having a team that's mixed, men and women, because it seems that our male architects like to definitely like to think about breaking the height barrier, so they kind of push us along that way. But it tends to be, let's see, this is really just showing how it's contrasting with some of the buildings around it. So the original idea came from thinking about topography and you know, would it be possible to design a building that has a landscape on it, or this is a drawing, an early drawing of the facade of the building, but as a topography. And so when we knew we were doing this building in concrete, it became interesting to think of it as maybe a sliced topography, you know, 82 slices. Every floor is a different shape. And then that creates a benefit for the interior. You know, you get these different terraces on the for the units. So sun shading, terraces, and also a form that would start to confuse the wind. That was our hypothesis, which ended up being correct. And so as the wind hits this building, it's going in different directions. It's not building up speed. So it actually makes the terraces more usable for more, you know, longer period during the year, because we have these horrible cold winters, but you have an extended mid-season where you can use the balconies. And it's also pretty interesting as an extension from the inside to the outside visually, and the fact that you can see other people on the building. And some of these are very large that you can, you know, literally have a party out there. The builders that were doing these concrete floors knew that I was really interested in birds in the city, and they actually photographed this guy, which is a peregrine falcon, on the Aqua Tower as it was being built. So these are a very urban bird as well. But people, like I said, they can see other people. It's more social because, you know, it's kind of more like similar to seeing someone across the fence, you know, in your backyard. And one of the major dwellers in this building are empty nesters coming back from the suburbs, coming back into the city. And so to have this outdoor space really made it attractive to people. And you can see other people because of the variation in the slabs. You get a good view, and there's a lot of different types of people living in there. There are graduate students, people in their first jobs, empty nesters, but evidently people are starting to get together on the building. That's what we've heard through the grapevine, that they're meeting, so it's a very social building. Another tower briefly, just another idea that came out of the original kind of Aqua ideas about the sun. is this building called the Solar Carve Tower. And again, I think it represents a kind of a vertical infrastructure for this one, this time for the city of New York. On the left is an image of the 1909 Hugh Ferris drawings that New York developed these zoning guidelines that led to the step-back skyscraper. And the reason for that was in order to maintain light and air getting down to the street. In our building, you can see it looks like the reverse of that, but I want to just emphasize why it is like that, and it really has to do with taking the same spirit of the code and applying it to a very specific situation. These are some iterations of the building. So in New York, this would be that cone-shaped thing is the zoning envelope. This building is located along the High Line in New York, which is a elevated former rail track that has a beautifully designed park along it. This is the standard hotel here. And so in the New York zoning code, you can build inside this envelope. And then you have a certain FAR that you can meet. So if I were to, you know, put in there what was allowed as of right without asking for any, you know, permission from the city, this is what we would end up with. And as you can see, the step back guidelines protect the street, but they do not protect an interior condition, which is the High Line is an exception. It's in the middle of the block. Our site was really located right along this West Side Highway and right along the Hudson River. So in a way, the step back doesn't really matter very much. There's no other things going on here. It's very bright. So we argued that we should take this volume and this red volume and take it away from the High Line, put it up on top of the building, go higher. And then we used solar angles to literally carve out the rest of the form to allow views to the Hudson from the High Line and to protect the gardens by allowing more light down. So I think by doing this, we got like 200 hours more of light hitting the High Line. But it produced a really interesting form that has a function. You know, it's allowing this light to come down, it's allowing light and views, but it's the antithesis of the step back skyscraper. But the good news is we did get approved for this form after months of meetings and public meetings, but the logic of it was so clear that it held the day. I want to talk just a moment about what kind of research that we're doing these days, integrating data and things like that to our work. I showed you earlier this migratory pathways in the Calumet region of birds. So in this project for Northerly Island, this became another important facet of it. This is called the Mississippi Flyway, and you know, thousands of birds use it every year going along the waterways. But when we started that project back in Calumet, there was no really way to kind of precisely see where these routes were. And now with the Northerly Island project, we're designing a space that's literally right on this waterway. In the meantime, technology has changed so much and advanced so much. There's a crowdsourcing application for logging sightings of migratory birds. This is an example of one out west. And what I think is really exciting about technology, it's not so much about the tools. The tools are there. We use the tools. They're important. The tools are everything. But it's really about the information for us and what to do with the information. And so here we have a beautiful project where there was a collaboration between the Nature Conservancy and a group called eBird, which is based in Cornell. And they discovered that instead of purchasing land to have waterways, to have water available for migrating birds, they paid farmers to create these almost like pop-up wetlands that would serve the same purpose. And so this is a beautiful use of technology. So with our Northerly Island project, we've been mapping and using crowdsourced data about bird migration to help us to figure out what kind of habitat is needed. And so this island, which is a former airport in Chicago, and it also served, it was a man-made island. It also served as a World's Fair site in 1934. Is an island that's completely defined by a sheet pile edge. And so in our design, as we worked through it, we found ways to pull out that edge again and to create a much more diverse habitat that's then going to serve as a place for people to engage with this habitat. So designing the section such that it will provide more space and more kinds of places, and designing the water so that it could be used for spawning fish. This is like making it a richer, more diverse habitat. And then I think the most interesting thing then is like, how do you bring people in contact with this and enrich their experience with the natural environment in the city? So hand in hand with towers, it's really important to think about natural areas. We're going to buy this ship online, which you can buy sunken ships, evidently, and find one and put it in there for divers. There's going to be a concert venue that will help fund the project up toward the north end. There'll be camping for youth in the city and access to this through a bridge in the winter where you can come over and do skiing as well. So I think what's interesting is conceiving of, you know, a landscape that's completely man-made, but instead of trying to just mimic nature, we're using the hex geometry to help create a space that is more legible as in a way, and more acknowledging that it's designed, as opposed to just trying to make it look completely like it was always there. So you see the landscape in how we are manipulating the existing soils that are on that site. So ripping out the edge, we're then putting in these islands that will help to break the wave action. Even though it's a lake, you get about like 16-foot waves in the winter, and that'll help protect us and make this into a really functioning wet area that people can use for recreation, but also to engage with wildlife. Right now, it's underway, and it just has this almost like Mayan feel to it. During the construction, it was discovered, we found this edge, which was the early edge of the island as they were filling in to create this place. So we're keeping that intact, and that's going to be a kind of a boardwalk through the center of a wetland. This is a great view of it from above. So about a third of the island, this is 90 acres, a third of it is under construction. I never really thought this was going to happen in my lifetime, but it was great because it was grants that were given to the park district for habitat creation, and they were able to make use of it on this project. I want to go back now to the last project here to show you, but go back to the idea of research and material research and typology research in our work. And this is a project that has opened 2 weeks ago, the Arcus Center for Social Justice Leadership. So it's kind of a middle-scale project. I showed you some small-scale projects, some landscape projects, some towers, and this project is really kind of in that 10,000 square foot middle-scale project, and it's a typology that we didn't we hadn't known about before. So it's, in a way, it's kind of the research here has to do with the typological research. This is on a campus called Kalamazoo campus in Michigan. It's a very small campus. They have about 2,000 students, and it's located in a kind of in a residential area. And this is an image of the campus, the area, and it's a beautiful little campus that has a kind of a colonial architecture. I guess you would call it Georgian architecture that is in the best looking part of the campus looks like this. But then there has been, you know, a lot of like newer structures that don't look this good, but are all 100% brick masonry. We had a kind of a crisis as we started to study what would be taught at the school. It's a social justice center. It's a place where students come to learn how to lead social justice causes and engage with faculty that are already teaching social justice and the public and try to make social justice a major, a something that people can learn and talk about and bring it into visibility. And I'll come back to the brick in a minute. But there wasn't really any examples of a social justice building. We found some vernacular things, but there really, you know, wasn't exactly this typology anywhere. So we started looking at spaces where social justice happens in the city, spaces of demonstration, streets, walls, graffiti. These are spaces where the action of social justice happens. At the time we were designing this, it was right in the middle of the Arab Spring, and there was this big demonstration in Tahrir Square. And on CNN, they had this incredible site where you could go and look at all the different parts. This is like a self-organized city in a way. We were very interested in that and how people move through the city and claim different parts of it. But the place where social justice is planned for action is really more in hidden spaces. So in the basements of churches and around the kitchen table and in the living room, this is the basement of the 18th Street Church where Martin Luther King really launched or planned some of the most important marches of the civil rights era. And so we really wanted to bring this visibility and bring it out of the basement, so to speak. These were other things that we looked at, which are, these are all vernacular meeting spaces that kind of gave us some inspiration. This one in Mali where they have a very low ceiling and the elders meet in this space and the ceiling keeps everyone seated so that nobody can get mad and angry and jump up. You know, it's like, stay calm. And some of these were based on, this is a Native American building where there's fire at the center or there's water at the center. People are facing inward. So those were really important. So on our site, you know, we felt like we wanted to, let's say, distance ourselves from the plantation era architecture because it really has nothing. It didn't, symbolically, did not jive with social justice at all. And also connect more to this grove that was on our site. So creating these three, it's kind of a triaxial plan with these three big windows, one facing the campus, one facing the neighborhood, and one facing this grove. And so that's how the plan kind of started. And the idea would be that you could definitely see right into the building and this social justice work would suddenly become visible. And this idea that the connections between the big windows are these gently arcing, kind of inflected walls that are embracing. So these were formal things that ended up coming into the plan And if you see as the plan developed, we had a need for more closed spaces along, and we started developing those along these edges here, and with a central space, a crossing space in the middle, where people could come together and have these maybe informal dialogues. As the plan developed, you can see that the Poche area became a little deeper, and then we used the line above the Poche as a clerestory for this plan. As well, you can see that, maybe you'll see it later in the photographs, but that each one of these ends has a different condition. This one is really cascading down to the hill. This one is really sitting squarely on the site, and this one is cantilevered over the hill that goes below it. So this is a section through the cascade, as we call it, and that allows the place to be used not for big scale meetings and conferences, as well as smaller scale. This was a rendering from the inside, where we would have this living room, a kitchen, and we took these places out of a domestic language and inserted them into this institutional building. So as we were trying to connect with this grove and the aspects of social justice and determining the walls of the building and the environmental approach to the building, we were really interested in using wood cladding. But in a campus setting that's all brick, you know, we were a little bit nervous about, you know, convincing someone to make this into wood. But as we started to research wood as cladding material, we found that there was a white cedar that's really very resistant to termites and also to rot. And this is the range of the white cedar here. That red outline is the shape of Michigan with its upper peninsula. And so the material was available right nearby. And it's a very strong, there's a lot of sustainably harvested white cedar as well. In the meantime, as we were kind of tooling across Michigan, we discovered this barn and a couple barns actually that actually used wood in a really interesting way. These are 100-year-old structures, and you can see that there's wood used on end in the walls. And so we thought, wouldn't it be interesting if we could like revive this technique? Like, no one knows how to do this anymore. But that would be such a great material for this building because it represents coming together. Usually these barns were done by a bunch of neighbors that would help out and build each other's barns. And we in looking this up and kind of digging into it, we found there was like one guy that still knew how to do this. His name was Rob Roy, Scottish name. And we found him and brought him in to the office. And then we started understanding the technique and thinking maybe this is possible and maybe this is a technique that is completely contemporary, because think about the sequestration of the carbon as opposed to the burning of bricks. So we did a workshop with Rob Roy and Jackie Roy, his partner, and learned, those are Studio Gang architects, like learning how to do this, building a sauna up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. And we discovered that this is actually a very viable technique for today. So we made some full-scale mock-ups. I really like the connection between like the individuality of each tree. You know, it's just a representation, the rings in the tree represent climate, like how much water there was that year, or if there was a drought, and they're all individual, just like the lines, you know, on a person's face. So we also wanted to push it further than the sauna architecture and realize that this is a little study model that you could actually get three-dimensional with this technique. And we proposed this eye-shaped window in one of the conference rooms. And so this is a little physical model that we made, and then really had to think through how are we going to apply this to a 21st century building. We ended up doing a wall that does have a small cavity, and we needed to finish the inside of the building while, because we didn't know how long this was going to take to do the outside, so we designed the building so it could be simultaneously being worked on the inside and the outside, and other sustainable features. And then we started to really get interested in the energy balance for this cordwood versus brick. So in the meantime, our client, which was the college, really was totally into this idea, and we had been going through meetings and neighborhood presentations and so on, and they really believed in it, which allowed us to actually do the work of getting the harvested logs, drying them out for an entire year while the building was moving ahead. But you can see that in this diagram, the amount of carbon that's used to make the wall, and then how much is sequestered within the wall. And so it's an incredible amount of sequestration in carbon. So this is like a fantastic technique for now. So the delta here is equivalent for this building of taking about 10 cars off the road, the emissions for 1 year. And then I'm just going to show you finally, this is an image during the winter of during construction. You can see the siding of the building here. It's comfortably far away from kind of the neighbor on this side. That's more of a different style of architecture, but it really connects to this grove in a nice way. And the scale at the side of the residential area is very low. So inside, from the inside, you have that kind of crossroads, the presence of fire, the conversation pit, you know, like reviving that too from the 60s, love it, and just making it some place that people feel comfortable, maybe sharing their stories that are not easy to share. You can see a conference room, a seminar room on the right, and then the higher ceiling in here due to the clerestory glazing. And from inside the conference room looking out, there you can see the kitchen. So this opened 2 weeks ago, and then like a week ago was the first conference that they had there on social justice. So it really got put into action right away. This is looking at this cascade, starting of the cascade, which is a kind of a stramp, ramp and steps that can be seated with chairs for a presentation, and looks right out onto that grove landscape. And so last week the place was pretty filled up, and it allowed, you know, the building to transform from something that's comfortable with small groups to something much larger. The offices, faculty offices, inhabit these little pockets in the poche area, and you can just substitute the windows for the log ends. Which means that the masons actually have to think about where the window's going to go. We couldn't totally control. It had to be, you know, a medium-sized log or a small log, and they had to place it and get it in the right spot for the plan. Here's a view of it from the campus side, where the entry. All of this is done so that. This site became accessible. It was formerly, it's such a high site that it's very difficult to access, but the social justice theme kind of came through for almost all of the very small things like access and like how to define restrooms without having to declare gender and many different things that I think we can use as architects going forward as well. So that's the cascade side on the left, and here's the cantilever side that looks out over the campus. This is that little window I was showing you, a model of. that looks brings light into the seminar room. That's what it looks like from inside looking out. And the texture is just really amazing. So as this weathers, it's really going to take on a slightly different aspect for the different exposures from north to south. And so now the building is just really getting put into use in this beautiful setting. So the Arcus Center for Social Justice, for me, I think it meant a lot to my practice in terms of the kind of projects I want to continue to do, the kind of projects that we all, like our whole office, really yearns to do. And so it's, to sum up, it's just a balance of, I think, for us, of maintaining this focus on the city and the post-industrial city, the research on different scales, and doing projects that have strong meaning for their users. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeanne. Wonderful exposition. The parallels, of course, between Chicago and Melbourne are enormous from what you've shown us. And the future post-industrial cities are so important to us both. You've taken us also through a very interesting journey, one we believe in enormously here, that research is the foundation of practice, of good practice, and that good practice comes out of thoroughly investigating dimensions of architecture and opportunity. You've looked at typology, morphology, materials. Now, particularly taken by the name of your book, Reverse Effects. It's about taking the R approach we have used now for a century or more and reversing it and trying to reverse engineer the process and come up with the alternative. So you've given us a very rigorous exploration of the morphologies of the tower, the explorations of materials from a city that embraced the tower so early. So thank you. It was an enormous diversity of projects. We're very grateful that you've defined design not as being the pursuit of a particular language, but more of an approach that by investigating form, material, and typologies leads us to an enormous diversity, a corpus of richness and unexpected opportunities. So thank you very much for the exposition.